All right, so I'm going to talk through trends in mobile advertising. There are loads of trends, obviously, in mobile advertising. So I've taken sort of four trends which are sort of globally for digital advertising probably the most important, and put them out here. So one, we've obviously got the rise of mobile advertising. We've all said it, we've all seen it. There's some graphs that you might find interesting in a bit. We've got our real-time bidding. I'll focus quite a lot on real-time bidding because I think it's the big wave that needs to be understood from an advertiser perspective. Data capture and user profiling, this comes down to what we were just talking about Facebook, but it's very important for real-time bidding because I think the essence of real-time bidding, I mean, how many of you are clear about real-time bidding and how it all works? Sort of, okay. All right, well, okay. Well, the basis of real-time bidding is that you're buying an impression that relates to a user in a specific context. So rather than with the Facebook thing, if you want to find people at 18 years old with friends in Chicago, but you're a bar, you probably want to find them on a site that's about, you know, drinking out in town in Chicago. You don't want to hit them on the Times when they're reading the news in the morning. So what happens real-time being, you do it, there's a lot of access to back-end databases. I'll show you some graphs and some diagrams in a minute, where they're checking all the data that they have available, and advertisers checking all the data they have available for them on a particular user before they serve an ad. Okay. And then the last one, and I put it in because, I'll show in a bit, but the content marketing and native advertising, which from a publisher perspective, is becoming far more important as an income stream. Okay, so mobile advertising, we've seen it really, it's quite odd because we've been working this for years, but it's in the last, for Joe Blogs on the street, it's in the last 18 months. So for advertisers, for in general, and for users, in fact, that you've seen mobile just completely taking over from desktop. You see the same in terms of the ad sales on even Google and Facebook. You know, they control most of the market, and you can see how they've, you know, basically over the last 3 years, they've tripled their income from mobile. On both, well, in the case of Facebook, you know, they were pushed to by the investment community. That was for the US. And it actually, perhaps it's most interesting in the US because the US is the biggest desktop market because it was obviously the first desktop market. So it, you know, everybody in the US has a phone. If you go to obviously Kenya or South Africa that we know well, you know, you just don't have this desktop. So the fact that this has happened really in the last, I mean, if you look at it, it's the last 12 months. That it's just completely taken over. This is what all the advertisers are seeing. And I think it's very important from a telemedia perspective because we're all performance focused. And when the big brands are seeing this data and the big brands are moving all their dollars to mobile, we have to be clever about what we're buying because there's more competition for the supply that's out there. Can we look at operating systems? Again, we see it all. The rise of Microsoft, Android's hit its sort of 50% market share. It's probably gonna sit there. Microsoft should go increasing after the Nokia thing. Symbian, well, obviously they got, you know, they dropped Symbian, so it's dropped down to nothing. And RIM, well, you know, it's where it is. This one, again, we all know it, but it's worth bearing in mind that in over the next sort of 5-6 years, almost all the growth in smartphone penetration is going to happen in Asia, China, and Asia Pacific. And obviously the rest of the world, so really it's LATAM to a certain extent and Africa. But it's worth bearing in mind, we know it all, but it's, you know, it modifies a lot the advertising industry generally. Okay, programmatic, this is where, for those of you who don't understand programmatic, basically what happens is a user hits a website, there's a tag there on the website, that calls an ad server. The ad server then auctions says to multiple buyers, I mean, we on our own RTB system, we have, I think, 60 buyers connected for almost every impression. They then look at the impression. They look at the user that's serving that impression, and this is why data, you'll see there at the bottom, data management platforms, data brokers, data is very important in this. They'll check the user, they'll see if they want to serve to that user for whatever reason. Just yesterday, I got a request from a weather news service that wants to sell us data so that you can relate, obviously, your ads to what the weather is at a particular location at a particular time that the user's in. They decide where they want it, they then bid on it, and then the highest bidder wins but pays the price of the second highest bidder. Okay. All that's done in 120 milliseconds. If you go over 120 milliseconds, where there's often problems, you know, we have our data centers. We don't have a data center in Asia because we don't do that much in Asia Pacific in terms of traffic. We have data centers in the US and in Europe. And often when we're bidding on traffic in Asia, we get timeouts. We go over 120 milliseconds, and it doesn't matter if our bid was the highest or not. We've lost that opportunity to buy. The programmatic, it's, you know, you see it's growing. It's currently, I'd say, it's about 20% of all advertising. In the next few years, it's going to go up to 40. I think if we actually look to all new advertising, so we're not looking at sort of historical campaigns that have been running for forever or the annual things that will always happen for big brands, I would say in the US, it's 90% of all new campaigns. Here in Europe, it's probably more like 50 already, but it's growing really fast. This is where I'll give you a sort of inside perspective on what's happening with programmatic, and I think it's very, very important from a performance perspective. Okay, because there's so much data and people are being so specific as to what user, what time, what location they're prepared to buy, you know, any particular impression might only have, say, 5 bidders. Okay, so we suggest it to 60, they go, no, it's not raining where that user is, suddenly it's down to 40, they say, oh no, he's aged over 30, suddenly we're down to 20, you know, we end up maybe with 5 bidders. Maybe at 1 o'clock at night, we've got 1 bidder. Now, if on an RTB campaign or sold impression, the second highest bidder wins, what happens when there's just 1 bidder? Well, it goes down to 0, so the buyer buys that impression for 0. So what publishers do is they set price floors, and they set automated price floors for different scenarios. So the price floor acts as a second bid. So if you've only got 1 bidder, it will only drop the price down to that particular price floor. Now, the reason it's important, I'm sorry it's a little bit maybe technical, but the reason it's important is if you look at this blue curve, okay, this is what will happen to fill rate, so the amount of traffic that a particular publisher will sell at given price floors. If you look at the orange one, this is the revenue that they will receive on given price floors, the total revenue. So if you actually look at the highest point, where this particular publisher will make most revenue is the price floor, I think it's $0.55, okay? But they're actually only going to be selling, you know, like 5% of their traffic. That has good connotations and bad ones. On the good side, it means that suddenly you've got a hell of a lot more traffic available to performance campaigns. On the bad side, publishers are far more picky about what advertisers they'll allow to serve, because they're already making more revenue than they were before they started selling on RTB. And this is where I come back to sort of native advertising, whatever. So they really do focus on the quality of the campaigns that they're receiving and if the campaigns fit what they're doing. This is just another example. I don't know if you've seen this happening, but this is just an example of how RTB is being used generally. This is actually the City of London Police have worked with a company really, really good, very expensive, called Project Sunblock, who are very good at determining where an impression's actually being served. And they've worked with Project Sunblock to target illegal content sites. You've seen it's a big thing at the moment in terms of copyright and new legislation. And they've been working with Project Sunblock to actually block the advertising that appears on the website. And instead of serving the ads that would normally have been served, they're serving ads saying this has been reported to the police. So, you know, that also has important connotations, obviously, performance, because this is the type of site that worked very well for performance campaigns. And if this starts to happen, then you know, we've got to be relatively careful. Okay. In terms of mobile programmatic, now programmatic generally is even more important on mobile than it is on PC, purely because mobile started later than desktop, so all the systems that have been built more recently, and so they've been more easily adapted, or from the scratch they've been built to work with RTB, whereas a lot of the sort of the older systems used by Yahoo, etc., weren't specifically built for RTBs, so they've had to make modifications. So, you know, in terms of what they're saying, you know, 30% of all mobile ad buys in 2013, 45% of all mobile ad buys in 2014, or in Q1, I think it was, 2014. Now, if we think that, going back to what we were looking at before, of overall RTB spend, which is about 20%, you know, it's twice as important on mobile. So it's twice as important, obviously, as advertisers for us to understand what's going on, indeed as publishers for us to understand what's going on. In terms of what's being bought, you know, it's mainly entertainment. A lot of that's because a lot of mobile advertising is obviously other applications running CPI campaigns, etc. All right. It's not terribly important, but just so that you see, this is how the RTB ecosystem works. So on the one side you've got the publishers and obviously the consumers. On the other side you've got the advertisers. In between you've got the trading desks, where they tend to be companies within media agencies that specifically concentrate on RTB buying. You've got demand side platforms. These are companies that sort of connect advertisers to publisher traffic using RTB, bearing in mind the kind of thing that I said with timeouts, milliseconds, etc. The infrastructure is quite important, so there are a lot of specific companies that deal with it. Some of them are really clever in terms of how they use artificial intelligence as well. You've got Rocket Fuel there. If you ever want to read about or learn a bit more about artificial intelligence in programmatic buying, just have a look at some of the videos their CTO has done. It's absolutely unreal. Then you've got the ad exchange to put everything together. You've got supply side platforms are basically doing the same from a publisher basis. And then you've got all the sort of brand protection. Well, that will be this Project Sunblock that I showed earlier. You've got the data partners. They're bringing in data from multiple sources so that people can do these checks on who the individual is that a particular impression is being served to. Data capture. Basically, what the data management partners are doing, or data brokers are doing, is they're taking data from everywhere. Okay, they're taking data from Visa, they're taking data from Amex, and they're taking data from the weather companies. They're taking cookie data, etc. They're putting it all together to create some really impressive profiles on users. This is where, if you look at those videos I said from the CTO of Rocket Fuel, you'll see some amazing stuff. And then they're using that in the purchase, obviously, the impressions. What does this end up with? Well, it ends up with personalized surfing. I mean, it might sound very simple, but you know, all of us receive a personalized page when we hit Facebook. You know, that didn't happen before, and as time goes on, it's happening more and more. And that content that we're receiving as we hit a page, so not just the advertising, the content itself, is becoming more and more personalized. The offline data, as I say, when you can buy access to credit card data from all the major credit card companies. When you link that data to, you know, other information that maybe you've got in your own database that you're taking from other third parties, you know, you can work out to a pretty high level of success who's actually going to purchase and who isn't at any particular point. As I say, American Express takes it a little bit further, and they try to track the user across the board.
But what are they trying to sort of learn, and what they use it for, American Express?
They use it to improve, theoretically, they use it to improve their customer service. American Express, you know, that their big selling point is customer service. We're going to assist you in everything. If they can know more about a user, they can assist them more in terms of, you know, the plans they're providing them, in terms of, you know, discount plans or
so
points
sort of
or loyalty points.
They, whatever they can get on you, they will
find
some
it, yeah.
value in it.
And they're selling it, you know. So they're selling this information as well. So it's not just improving their customer service. It's also another business stream. People are using auctions as ways of farming data. I mean, this is the big complaint that publishers have, the big publishers. You know, we had this, there was the talk earlier from Mark Chernow where he was talking about data press as data sources. Well, you know, what a lot of people are doing is they're actually running campaigns, and they might not even, to a certain extent, so it depends on the contracts that you have. Sometimes you don't even actually have to buy the impression. You're just taking the data from the R2B auction, even though you're putting in a low price. You're user matching, you're collecting data on what users, surfing the FT, and then you're buying that same user on another site that's, you know, 50 times cheaper. You try to buy the FT, it's going to cost you £80 CPM. You try to buy that site with the illegal content earlier, it's probably going to cost you 10 cents. You know, if you can farm data from the FT and use it to serve to another site, well, you know, there's and some big companies are doing that. I mean, it's not just the white boys, you know. Audi's run campaigns.
That's all legal.
Well, it's yeah, because there's no personal data. You're just you know, it's just
It doesn't break any sort of advertising codes or
No, because in the European laws, you're already accepting on all the sites now that they can use cookies. I know they're trying to modify it or whatever. In the US, there's, you know, it's industry regulated, and you know, you can just do it. And then there are other jurisdictions where there aren't even any, you know, there is no legislation on this particular point in place. And then you've obviously got the cross-device data and where, you know, Facebook and Google are farming everything that we're doing. Whenever we do a login on any page, well, they're seeing where we're going, what we're doing, and they're adding it into their big profiles. And as I say, Facebook has now opened this up on a beta trial to two advertisers in the US, and obviously that's where they're going. I was actually in a meeting with them 2 weeks ago today, and with their video arm, and we were talking about this, and okay, what's your future stuff, and the data. You know, we're going to provide access to all our data for all the videos that we make. Okay. Content marketing. The reason I mention this is, firstly, because as I say, there's, from a publisher perspective, there's more and more, and there will be ongoing, more and more focus on the quality of the advertising that's being provided. Publishers, particularly the sort of the bigger media companies, they see their only future in terms of advertising, really, in terms of native advertising. So if you see something like BuzzFeeds that most of us will know, if not all of us, you know, it is only based on native advertising. That's all they're into. You know what native advertising is, do you, or not? Okay. Native advertising is basically advertising editorial content that is basically advertising. So if you go on to a BuzzFeed's thing, you might see an article about 10 ways to dress up your cat, and it's sponsored by, you know, some cat food, and I can't remember what the cat food...
Whiskers.
That's it, Whiskers. You know, you'll see that kind of stuff. And for the big editorial companies, this is, you know, this for them is the future, because they have all these, they have all the journalists. They have to find a way to differentiate themselves from, you know, the basic blog that's out there, and this is their opportunity. So there's a huge focus from a publisher perspective on native advertising. It's going to become bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, from an advertiser perspective, if the publishers start to be more selective as to what we serve, as to what they will allow us to serve, it suddenly becomes more and more important to look at a user from a global perspective and provide content, advertising content that fits the publishers as best as possible. So here you've just got all the opportunities that you really have in terms of converting a user from your contests to your communities to your business cases, your webinars. You know, it's really looking from a business perspective, B2B perspective, rather than direct to consumer. But it's just that I think you have to look, particularly now that we're talking cross-device. So the average household in the US, I think, has 9 different devices and just under 3 people. So some of those devices are shared. You know, the PC in my house is shared, the tablet is, even the mobiles are, but the mobile is shared maybe with, 3 people, and the computer is shared with 5. You know, and this is where the data management partners and the tracking of users is so more important. But you know, there's cross-device, there's cross-content. I think we, as publishers become more concerned about the quality of the advertising, it becomes more important to try and close down a user at any point of what they're doing online, whether it's interacting on Facebook or not. All right, just the final thing, basically about us, just so you understand. Half the room know us very well, but basically we're an interactive marketing group. We've got 2 advertising companies, and one which is mobile entertainment, mobile billing. We've got mobile billing in 12 geos. We track as a data. We're not really a data management platform, but we do collate data, but on behalf of our advertisers. We've got data on about 450 million users worldwide, 150 million video views, 3,000 managed publishers, loads of segments, loads of different channels of our different publishers.